Hey, brothers and sisters, you know, there's one of these old gospel songs, an old hymnal song, I believe it was written by Charles Wesley. It's called, "Oh, for a thousand tongues to sing, my great Redeemer lives. Hallelujah, blessed be the name of the Lord." Brothers and sisters, you know, I was just thinking about it tonight. I was here praying, and I was just thinking, you know, because I didn't get a chance to pray yesterday. I missed a day. And as no, you know, we're not by works. But, you know, when... Let me say this to all you who don't know these things, who just have it here. You know, the Lord has always been leading me to work with those who are spiritually handicapped and who have all form of godliness but deny the power thereof. You know, if you haven't had an encounter with the Lord, with His Holy Spirit, if you haven't had an encounter with the Lord, you don't know what you're missing. And I was just, you know, it was in my mind while I was here praying, you know, as soon as I began to pray, the Holy Spirit just, you know, just hit me. Sometimes the Holy Spirit just kind of comes in slowly upon you, and then sometimes, boom, it just comes in. And the glory, the you know, the Hebrew word for that glory of God is really a weight, the weighty presence of the Lord. It's just like a weight pressing down on you, you know, of His glory. And then, as I mentioned the other day, there's different feelings of the Holy Spirit, how the Lord operates, healing, evangelism, conviction of sin, whatever the Lord is doing and leading in you or in others. He moves in different ways. As Jesus said, the wind blows. John chapter 3, the Lord said, you see the wind, it blows. You see the effect of the wind, but you can't see the wind. So that's how the Holy Spirit is. He blows as the Lord, as the way the Lord wants to move in different ways. Anyway, brothers and sisters, as I was laying here in the Spirit of the Lord, this boom came on me. And I missed a day praying. Yesterday, well, I did pray some, but not formally. Not like formally. I was praying while I was going. I went somewhere, and I prayed all the way there and all the way back. I had to go to the bank. But anyway, as I was praying, and the Holy Spirit just came upon me, and I was just thinking, man, you know, I think I would give up everything I know in this world for the Lord, for knowing the Lord, the presence of the Lord. Not just saying, oh, you're saved. That's the thing about these people that, oh, I know I'm saved. I know I'm saved. As they call it, mental assent. John Wesley, the founder of the Methodist Church, called it mental assent. They know in their mind. They say in their mind, oh yeah, I agree with the Word of God. I agree that the Bible is real. What does it say? I don't want to get into all that. What does it say in James? It says, you know, even demons believe in God and tremble, but don't you know, oh vain man, faith without works is dead. Of course, the works is the fruit of our relationship with the Lord. You know, show me, and James said, show me your faith without works. I'll show you my faith by my works. Even as the Apostle Paul said in that text that people love to quote, Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8 and 9, he said, by grace are you saved through faith, not of your own, but a gift of God, not by works, lest any man should boast. About two or three verses later, he says that we're saved unto do good works. You know, and Paul also said, who God did foreknew, who He foreknew, He foreknew we would say yes or no to Him. He foreknew we would get saved. He foreknew whether we'd be baptized in the Holy Spirit. He foreknew whether we would go be missionary or a pastor or an evangelist or what it was that we would do. And He predestined. He predestined good works for us to do in accordance with the calling that He gave us. For His gift and callings are without repentance, the Bible says in that same text. Anyway, brothers and sisters, I was thinking I've thought about this many times in the past. Like the day I remember when I was baptized in the Holy Spirit, and I thought to myself, how did I live? You know, I was just walking by totally by faith and not by sight before that point. From the time I came back to the Lord. Well, I got saved when I was a child. I really got saved. And I never stopped believing in the Lord, but I was a backslider as a teenager, young adult. And then the Lord called me to the ministry. I came back to the Lord. And then, you know, I was walking with the Lord totally by faith, 100% by faith, walking by faith and not by sight. But brothers and sisters, when I received, I want to talk about this because the Lord told me to earnestly contend for the faith and for your filling of the Holy Spirit. The Bible says, the Lord is just reminding me of this too, it says there in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, to covet, to prophesy, to covet, to earnestly desire and be jealous, even as Paul, even as the Lord said in His Word, that He uses the Gentile church to provoke Israel to jealousy. So the Lord wants to provoke people to jealousy, to prophesy. That's what it says, to covet, to prophesy. You know what it means? Where it says in the Ten Commandments, thou shalt not covet thy neighbor's ass or his wife. Not to just be, oh, I just want to have that. I'm so envious of my neighbor because he's got this beautiful wife or he's got great possessions and I would like to have that. That's what it's saying in the Ten Commandments. But yet the Apostle Paul said that we should covet to prophesy. We should be envious, provoked to jealousy, instead of throwing stones and saying, oh, that's not from God. If I've got one elderly, very elderly Baptist relative. It's been a church breaker and been breaking up churches for 80 years, 70 years. And this old Pharisee said, well, if speaking in tongues is for today, I'd do it. I would be the first one to do it. If God didn't give it to me, I don't believe he'll give it to anybody else. That is a classic example of a self-righteous Pharisee. When in reality, it's because of their arrogance and pride and lack of repentance and walking in the flesh and not according to the Spirit, why they haven't been baptized in the Holy Spirit, brothers and sisters. Because we need to be repentive. If you just got saved today, you're a perfect candidate to receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit. If you've been a Christian for 20 years and live in the greasy grace, hyper grace lifestyle, you need to repent. What is it? You know, the other day, brothers and sisters, when I made a video and I quoted from, like I said, I think I'm going to stop deleting wacky comments so that people can see the things that people say, because I go delete them. But maybe if you saw the video and then you wouldn't go back and see it, you wouldn't see the comments. But so hilarious, brothers and sisters. I mentioned in the video the other day that Revelation chapter 2 and chapter 3, God, the Lord Jesus spoke to the churches and said to repent to each church, except for Philadelphia, Revelation 3, 9 and 10, along in there. He told those churches to repent, the people in the church who were living in sin. And he said what the things he liked about the church and the things he didn't like, and those who were doing the things he didn't like practicing, you know, the thing of Jezebel and all this, and tolerating Jezebel and all this, that they need to repent and come back to their first love. It's like the first church. That's what he tells them. Repent and come back to your first love. And then he has a condemnation and rebuke for all the churches but Philadelphia. So anyway, brothers and sisters, someone messaged me, once saved, always saved, greasy gracer, living in la-la land, messaged me on, commented on the video and said that he wasn't talking to Christians. He was talking to non-believers. He was talking to he wasn't talking to the church. He was talking to non-believers. Now, anybody that would read Revelation chapter 2 and 3, those are the seven letters to the seven churches in Asia Minor, to the church at Pergamum. You know, all those ones, Philadelphia, all the Laodicea, all, you know, that's the church age we're living in now, the lukewarm church age, the Laodicean church age, that's where we're living right now. Okay, and there's another verse that I was going to quote that reminded me of what I just told you. 1 John 1:9, I quote it all the time. And before that, it says, if we sin, the beginning, 1 John chapter 1 says to the, you know, to the church, it is written to the church. Read the first verse. It's written to the church of Jesus Christ. And then on there, he says, if we sin, we have an advocate with the Father. That's the Lord Jesus Christ. And then in verse 9, he says, 1 John chapter 1, verse 9, John says, he's talking to the church. Not to the world, not to non-believers, not saying you must be born again. He says to the church, if we confess our sins, he is just and faithful to cleanse us, to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us of all unrighteousness. That's the church, brothers and sisters. That is the church. We must repent. We must live, and we must live a life of humility and repentance. Brothers and sisters, I caution you because the Lord told me, just right when I was getting ready to start this video, I was going to talk about, you know, the joy of the presence of the Holy Spirit. That's really the topic of my video. But just as I was getting to hit start on this video, the Lord said, talk to the greasy gracers. Talk to the greasy gracers. Yes, the Lord used the term that I've been using because he talks to us in a way we can understand. The Lord doesn't speak to me in Hebrew because I'm not fluent in Hebrew. He doesn't speak to me in Filipino. I'm not fluent in Filipino. He speaks to me in my language in the way I can understand, in a way, an exact expression that I can understand. Not the way they spoke 500 years ago. He doesn't speak to me in Elizabethan English, even though he knows if I know a King James Bible verse, he will put that King James Bible verse in my spirit and it'll be in the same language as the King James Bible. But anyway, I'm trying to deal and talk to the spiritually inept, the spiritually handicapped, the spiritually deceived, the spiritually compromised, those who have an objection to the Holy Spirit meter, ministry, you know, to the Holy Spirit ministry, OHM, ohms, or the Holy Spirit meter, as I talked about in my video the other day, the objection to the Holy Spirit meter, I can feel it when I pray for people, but for you, it's objection to the Holy Spirit ministry. The Holy Spirit's trying to minister to you. He's another comforter, and you've rejected him. You've rejected one-third of the Godhead, the Holy Spirit. Anyway, brothers and sisters, as I'm trying to minister to you today, and tell you that if you will confess your sins, the Lord will forgive us of our sins and cleanse us of all unrighteousness. That's Christians. We are called to follow Jesus. So listen to me. I want to caution you. People, you know, yourself, you've heard it's been said, you know, this thing that, you know, by grace are you saved, but by faith and not by works, lest any man should boast. You've heard that's been said, but brothers and sisters, I can give you 100 Bible verses, for New Testament Bible verses, for every Bible verse that a greasy gracer comes up with. As I've said, Jesus said, anyone who follows me must deny himself and pick up his cross and follow me. Anyone who puts his hand to the plow and looks back is not worthy of me. Jesus repeats these things over and over and over again. Matthew chapter 7, he said, not everyone, listen to me. I just started to speak in Filipino and say, do you understand? Maybe I should say it in Italian. Kabish, ich verstehen Sie, that's German, in Filipino, Bisaya magpasabuka. Do you understand when Jesus says this? Listen to me. Attention here, spiritually handicapped. Jesus said in John chapter 7, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord. Jesus said, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but he that does the will of my Father. Now, what part of that do you not understand? People who call him Lord. But the Bible says, all who call upon the name of the Lord will be saved. All who call upon the name of the Lord will be saved. But you know what that expression means, call upon the name of the Lord? It means to repent. Call upon the name of the Lord when you repent and you're baptized. Calling upon the name of the Lord. It means to repent. It's an expression also, not just Lord Jesus. Lord Jesus what? Lord Jesus. Lord Jesus what? I repent. I'm sorry. I confess I'm a sinner. I'm in need of forgiveness. And I need to humble myself and follow you. What did Jesus tell the disciples? Oh, do you believe I'm the Christ? Yeah, okay, bye. No, he didn't say that. He said, follow me, and I will make you fishers of men. Follow me. That's what he said to them. That's what he says to us. He who does not pick up his cross daily, deny himself and follow me, he's not worthy of me. How much, you know, I'm just thinking, because the Lord told me to say these things, I'm just thinking of all the New Testament Bible verses that I've already mentioned. Revelation chapter 2, chapter 3, Matthew chapter 7, the other times when Jesus said, take up your cross and deny yourself and follow me. When Jesus says, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but he that does the will of my Father. Brothers and sisters, instead of mocking the things that you don't understand and denying the power of God, you have a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof, the Lord, in his grace and mercy, just like when you were totally lost and people that are lost and without hope in this world, as the Bible says, not as some lots of famous preachers keep saying, when you're not saved, you are not saved, and you're not going to heaven some other way just because you had good intentions. It says that those who are not saved, as the Bible says, they are lost and without hope in this world. Enemies of the oracles of God, enemies of the things of God. Brothers and sisters, the Lord in his infinite mercy and wisdom, just like he did with me and everybody else, he wants you to be baptized in his Holy Spirit. He wants to fill you with his Holy Spirit. He wants you to experience the earnest of your salvation. Brothers and sisters, the Lord's Holy Spirit is here for those who will receive. Jesus said, out of your belly, John chapter 7, out of your belly would flow rivers of living water. God wants to pour his Spirit out on all flesh. He said in Joel chapter 2, then in Acts chapter 2, in the last days I'll pour out my Spirit on all flesh. It says your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your old men will dream dreams. Your young men will see visions. God wants to do that stuff with all of his people. All of his people. Brothers and sisters, I pray right now that the Lord would take away your cynical, self-righteous, mental assent and false conversion of all of you greasy gracers and humble your heart by his Spirit, that you would truly get born again. And any truly born again believer has a desire for the things of God. And the things of God are his Spirit. Jesus said, I send you another comforter. I send you another comforter, just like him. in the language there in the original Greek. Yes, the New Testament was written in Greek, not Hebrew. In the original text in the Greek, when Jesus says, I send you another comforter, it's saying that Jesus is a comforter and that he's sending another one just like him, equal to him. God the Holy Spirit is equal to God the Son and God the Father. God the Holy Spirit is God. But yet, you think you can have Jesus? You think you can have the Father without the Holy Spirit? Brothers and sisters, these things cannot be. You cannot separate God from the Son. As Jesus said, John said this. John said this in 1 John. He who has the Father has the Son. And maybe Jesus said it, I'm sorry. But you can't have the Son without the Father. And you cannot have the Father without the Son. So those people who say they know, just like Jewish people, what the Bible is saying is those people say they know the Father, but they don't have Jesus. You can't have the Father without the Son. That's why Jesus said, just like Jesus said in the Gospel of John, you don't know me or my Father. Because if you knew my Father, you would know me because I come from the Father. I come out from the Father. So if you can't have the Father without the Son, and you can't have the Son without the Father, you can't have the Son without the Holy Spirit, and you can't have the Father without the Holy Spirit. You can't have the Holy Spirit and not have the Son. It's one God. So you can't pick and choose with this cafeteria Christianity. Oh, I don't want none of that. How do you suppose you can mock people speaking in tongues and all that and blaspheme? In my opinion, you are tap dancing on blaspheming the Holy Spirit. And you think that you could have Jesus without the Holy Spirit? Don't you know that it's the Spirit of God, the Holy Spirit that indwells believers? How could you have the Holy Spirit, the wellspring of living water, John chapter 4, inside you, born again Christian, and yet reject the work of the Holy Spirit? How can you not know? If you're really saved, you would discern and know that's the Holy Spirit. Brothers and sisters, you have been judgmental, self-righteous, arrogant, supposing and posing with a form of godliness but denying the power thereof. See, God has seasons where he does things. And this is a season of pardon. And I guess the Lord has just prompted me to title this video, Season of Pardon to the Lukewarm Church. For the window is closing. Behold, the door, the Lord stands. The Lord's given to me now. Revelation chapter 3, verse 22. Behold, I stand at the door and knock at the door of my church. That's us. We are the church, the Laodicean church, the lukewarm church in the end times. I stand at the door and knock. Anyone who will let me in, I'll sup with him and he'll sup with me. Now that's what I'm telling you. You need to let the Lord into your heart. Not in here. You got it all right here. But I'm telling you, your heart is stony cold. Stony cold. You are stiff-necked and hard-hearted people who have always rejected the Holy Spirit. Now I know some of you that's all filled with the enemy's power. It's doing just like the Jews did to Stephen, as I just quoted from Stephen from Acts chapter 8. They gnashed their teeth and plugged their ears and yelled and took Stephen out to stone him. Brothers and sisters, I suppose if some of you are in my presence, you might try to stone me. But I also suppose that by the grace and mercy of God, here I stand in his grace. As the Lord wills, as long as the Lord wills, I stand in his grace to preach his word. Not by might nor by power, but by his Spirit. Hallelujah. Blessed be his name. Blessed be the name of the Lord forevermore. More power and honor and glory be all to our Lord and our Savior Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. For he is a mighty God. He is a holy God. He's a worthy of God of all your praise and worship. Now, the Lord tells us, you know, that we are not to, try to judge things before their time. So my advice to you from the Spirit of the Lord, stop trying to judge and worry about what's going on. And you know, where you think there's, oh, this is an abuse of the Holy Spirit, this or that, the other, all those things. God didn't call you to do all those things. He called you. 99% of the people, you're not in the ministry. God didn't call you to be a pastor. Okay, it's not your job. God called you to be like right here with him. He's looking for you to be right here in a personal relationship with him. Not worried about all them other things going on around you. All this trouble and storms going on in the world. Just like he told Peter, you know. He called Peter out there. Peter said, can I walk on the water? Jesus said, come on, you know, come. Peter stepped on the water, it says he was walking on the water, and as soon as he started looking at the storms around him, he started sinking. Now, that's what most people are doing when it comes to spiritual things. They're worried to death about what everybody else is doing. God didn't call you that. He called you to come up here and sit with him in heavenly places, to open your heart and let him in, have a personal relationship with him and all the fullness thereof, all the things that God would have for you to do. Get that. And then, I mean, that's the problem with 90% of people. You know, by God's grace, when I was called by the Lord, even though I was really got saved when I was 8 years old, when the Lord called me back, it was 6 months before I even started teaching Sunday school of intense study. And then I went to Bible school and all those things. And I still didn't, you know, go out here getting all involved in judging and all those things. As I mentioned in my video, I was at the Baptist church. I didn't sit there and start trying to correct the pastor and all this kind of stuff, even though I thought, well, what they're saying is not right. And I took it to heart. I didn't go brand new off the street corner out here trying to, you know, correct people's been in the ministry for 20, 30 years. You know, that's the first sign of immaturity, arrogance, and pride. And pride goes before a fall, a haughty spirit before destruction. Humble yourself, sit down, shut up, and learn something from somebody. God sends mentors into our lives, His Holy Spirit, and then His servants, preachers, people who are ordained and called by God to teach His people, to preach to His people, to lay hands on His people, to minister to His people, to lead His people into the paths that the Lord wants them to walk in. That's the purpose of people who are elders in the body of Christ, who are teachers and preachers and pastors and evangelists and all those things. It tells us Ephesians chapter 4, verse 11. But 99% of you guys, you need to sit down and receive the things of God before you out here trying to, you know, you can, evangelism is one thing. You go out here and tell people John 3:16, evangelize people. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about out here trying to be some kind of a high theologian and you know, and I mentioned this many times in videos. You know, do you see a video on the internet on how to do brain surgery, then go to the doctor's, walk into the surgery suite at the local hospital? Whoa. You're not doing that right. I know all about it because I saw a video on YouTube. I read a book about it. I can copy and paste the step-by-step instructions to brain surgery. Come on. Anyway, brothers and sisters, I'm starting to clown around with it a little bit and be funny with it. But anyway, brothers and sisters, God bless you guys. You know, my original thing I started talking about was the presence of the Lord. Those of you guys which are the majority of my viewers, you've been baptized in the Holy Spirit. You've been filled with the Holy Spirit. Excuse me, don't forget. I mean, revival is the Lord bringing us back to that first day when we were saved, when we got baptized in the Holy Spirit. Brothers and sisters, I would say that the greatest, you know, when I got saved, of course, that's awesome. It's the greatest day of my life. But when I was baptized in the Holy Spirit and I really felt the fullness of the presence of the Lord, that is the greatest experience I ever had, being baptized in the Holy Spirit. You know, really, really, you know, experiencing, you know, a taste of heaven. There's nothing like it, brothers and sisters. So I challenge you to be covetous to prophesy, to be covetous for the gifts of the Spirit, to be covetous to be filled with the Holy Spirit. And not feel like I read comments of people on videos, you know, as I've perused the internet and I watch the comments of trolls and stuff and people who are trolling and you know, attacking people in comments is what I mean by troll on somebody's videos. And I see their comments and they always say something like, oh, those people's been baptized in the Holy Spirit. They think they're better. They made me feel like I wasn't as good as them because I didn't speak in tongues. That's your flesh talking. No. Instead of worrying about how those other people made you feel, you need to worry about the way Jesus makes you feel. You need to worry about your personal relationship with Jesus and being filled with His Holy Spirit, not what other people think. That's the devil talking to you. That's the demons keeping you from being filled with the Holy Spirit. That's not from the Spirit of God. To be judging these people, oh, they think they're better than me. No. You think you're not as good as them. You are using an excuse to hide from the Holy Spirit, making up all kinds of vain imaginations to avoid the holiness of God. I tell you what, this is a real truth. The reason why, I'll tell you the honest truth. You want to know what's the truth in your heart? And I speak this as the Lord has just prompted me to tell you this. The real reason why you don't want to be baptized in the Holy Spirit, or why you're making up doctrines and doctrines of devils and hiding from the Holy Spirit, because you're afraid of God's holiness. Because you're full of sin. You're full of the devil. And you know that if you get the Holy Spirit gets up on you, the holiness of God, that fire is going to light your behind up. That's what you're afraid of. Because you know the Lord's going to put you on your knees and break you down and bust that hard head of yours. That's what you're afraid of. That's why you're afraid of the Holy Spirit. Because of the holiness and righteousness of a holy God. It scares you. I don't blame you. You better repent. You better repent. Because when judgment day comes, there ain't no hiding from the Lord. You can't hide from him then with all your secret little sins and carrying on and whatnot. Trying to be all arrogant, bowed up, walking around, strutting around. Talking about, my past, present, and future sins, I forget. Especially future sins. Keep on strutting around talking that mess. Keep on keeping on, brother. Keep on. Thou shalt not be moved, huh? Don't be moved. Don't be moved. Don't be moved. Go ahead and keep strutting around your flesh. And then when that judgment day comes, the Lord's going to move you. The Lord's going to move you. I'm praying for you guys. I'm praying for those who are stiff-necked and hard-hearted. That's all I can tell you. I ask you guys just to pray for those who mock the Holy Spirit, those of you who are Spirit-filled, and those of you who are seeking the Holy Spirit. Many of you are seeking the Holy Spirit. As you know, those who are seeking the Holy Spirit know I'm not talking about you. I'm talking about those who deny the Holy Spirit. They have a form of godliness, but they deny the power thereof. Let's pray for them in their self-righteousness and pride that they would humble themselves. That's exactly what it is. And, the Lord is just putting a fire under me to kick up the heat. You know, I'm going from jalapeno to habanero. I'm going to habanero preaching from jalapeno. It's already been hot, but now it's about to go. You know, you can't, some people can eat jalapenos and it don't really bother them. You know, at least not on the way down. But them habaneros, boy, not too many people can fake with a habanero. You know, you got to get some milk. Get that drink down. The milk of the word and the milk of the spirit to get that fire of the jalapeno out of your mouth. Habanero out of your mouth. God bless you guys. You know that I love you guys. And I'm just having a good time in the Lord tonight. And it's just because, the Lord has given me a joy. The joy of the Lord is my strength. Because, all the time I've been in the ministry, that, these religious Pharisees have really gotten me fired up. You know, the Lord has used that. As I've said before in my videos in the past, those of you who have watched it, the secret to your destiny is what gets you mad. There's nothing wrong with being mad if you have righteous indignation. You know, that's just a flowery way of saying you're mad. If you're mad about something, it's a clue that God's called you. That if it makes you mad about abortion, God's called you to do something about it. Go talk to young pregnant teens and invite them to live with you, and help them get their kid adopted and all this kind of stuff, whatever it may be. You get all fired up about rape, women being raped, then, and you're a woman, you're going to go counsel women and pray for women that's been raped, talk to men about, violence and things like whatever, minister to people in these situations that make you mad. So what always fires me up is old fake self-righteous religious hypocrites, old bunch of Pharisees full of hate and debate and strife and anger and no love of Christ, no Holy Spirit in them. It's all a bunch of self-righteous foolishness, full of sin, taking the Lord's name in vain. You talk about taking the Lord's name in vain. It's talking about, I love Jesus Christ and living for the devil. That's taking the Lord's name in vain in my book, my definition. Using his name as if you belong to the Lord and you don't. A bunch of false converts, mentally assented Pharisees, have a form of godliness but deny the power thereof. But you know what, brothers and sisters, this week the Lord is just putting this, I got a joy because, victory is mine. A victory for the church, the true bride, those five wise virgins. Victory is ours. Victory is at hand, brothers and sisters. We're about to have victory over the world, the flesh, the devil, death, hell, and the grave. We're about to be snatched up out of here. And those people that's going to be standing there, in my own heart, of course, we feel sorry for everybody, but I particularly feel sorry for those who are lost, especially, in all these other countries where there's not many Christians and they never really heard the gospel too much and all that. We should, like the Muslims and all these wicked people, but a lot of them don't know any better. They're ignorant. They never heard the gospel. But these old Pharisees, especially like in America and the Western countries, boy, they're going to be looking stupid. They're going to be looking stupid, brothers and sisters, when them five foolish virgins is going to be looking stupid, brothers and sisters. And it is sad, sad, sad. sad, sad, sad. Don't be part of that group. Don't be part of the five foolish virgins. Matthew chapter 25 is what I'm talking about. Be part of the five wise virgins. Get your lamp full of oil. Keep your oil. That's the Holy Spirit. Be full of the Holy Spirit. Walk in the fullness thereof. Walk in the anointing of God. Follow Jesus. Take up your cross daily and follow Jesus. We overcome this world by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. Jesus told the church, and that's from the word of God. And then also in Revelation, Revelation chapter 3, verse 10, Jesus told the one church of Philadelphia, because you have patiently kept my word, I will keep you out of the hour of temptation that will come upon the whole world and try all the people who live on earth, because you have patiently kept my word. Not just because you're born again, but you patiently kept my word. You have kept the, and in the King James, it's you have kept the word of my patience. Same thing. Luke chapter 21, verse 36. Jesus told us about the tribulation. Luke chapter 21, verse 36. Then he said, watch therefore and pray always. Not one time, not one sinner's prayer. Pray always that you be counted worthy to escape these things and stand before the Son of Man. Don't let anybody twist that scripture to try to tell you that you don't have to walk with the Lord. You don't have to walk in holiness to go in the rapture. That you don't have to walk in holiness to enter the kingdom of heaven. Don't let anybody tell you that. I'll give you 100 verses for every greasy grace twisted Bible verse. I will give you 100 Bible verses to support what I said. I've already mentioned dozens in this video. I pray. Well, you know, the Lord is just prompting me again. What did Jesus say? He who has an ear, let him hear what the Holy Spirit says to the church. So I pray right now that let's pray for those. I ask you, brothers and sisters who have an ear to hear. Let's pray for those who don't have an ear to hear, because the devil has blinded them. Their ears are stopped up. They're stopping up their ears, gnashing their teeth, as I said, like they did to Stephen in Acts chapter 8. I pray that they have an ear to hear. Be humble. I pray the Lord will give you a humble spirit. Don't let the rapture be what humbles you. Don't get left behind. Don't let being left behind be what it takes to humble you off of your high horse. Nobody's perfect. Brothers and sisters, it's so complicated in the mind of religious people, but yet so simple and childlike. As Jesus said, you must become like a little child to enter the kingdom of heaven. It's all the thoughts and intents of your heart, brothers and sisters. Nobody's perfect. Nobody's perfect. It's that humble, repentant heart saying, I'm a sinner. I need your daily help. I need to repent daily. Not, oh, as some of these people say, well, you know, the Lord's already forgiven me of my sins. I'm forgiven of future sins. I'm just going along my merry way, not following Jesus, living and doing it my way, walking on my own path, and because I said a sinner's prayer 20 years ago and going to heaven. Don't you believe that? You have to have a humble, repentant, repentant heart. You know, Jesus, help me. Jesus, help me to overcome this world. Jesus, forgive me. You know, Lord, help me and save me, Lord. Deliver me, Lord, out of my own folly and my own foolishness, Lord. You got to walk with the Lord daily. God bless you guys. I've been going on and on about it. I'm just trying to get this out. Brothers and sisters, time is short. Who knows, you know, what tomorrow may hold? Who knows what events may happen in this world? You know, as we talked about, you know, we mentioned about destruction in the United States, but, you know, the Lord has just brought me back in remembrance, and he told me to go back and reread the vision of George Washington. And he's, you know, in that vision of George Washington, President George Washington of the United States will not be totally destroyed, but there will be a remnant of the United States to be saved. The Union will be preserved until the Lord returns. So that's what the dream, the vision of George Washington. But anyway, brothers and sisters, I have in my heart have total peace no matter what may happen. I'm not saying that something's going to happen on September 11th tomorrow or not. I don't know. The Lord didn't tell me that. I know that there will be destruction coming to, you know, judgment of the Lord coming to the United States, like the Harbinger stuff from Rabbi Kahn. I know that. We know that's coming. But, you know, my rest is in the Lord. I am with the Lord already. I'm already with the Lord. You know, so when the rapture happens, or if I was to be killed in some kind of tsunami or nuclear war or earthquake or whatever it may be, I'm already with the Lord, brothers and sisters. What you're seeing now is just a vapor. What you're seeing now is just the shadow of my spirit. You're just seeing the shadow of my spirit. You're just seeing my hind parts. But my spirit's already passed by. I'm already with the Lord, brothers and sisters, seated far above all powers and principalities and forces of darkness. I'm seated with Christ on his throne already, because that's what he says in his word, that his true Christians are seated with him on his throne already, far above all powers and principalities and evil and weakness and sickness and disease. My spirit's already there, brothers and sisters. What you've seen is just the aftershock of me getting raptured. God bless you guys. Those of you who understand dimensionalism and hyperdimensionalism and all those things, you know what I'm talking about. I'll see you up there with our Lord.